This is the time for Christmas carols. It is a time of joy and of celebration, of fellowship, of a little bit of rest, of the peace of the salvation of our God. And in the West, these 12 days of Christmas are indeed a time of celebration. We even have the song about it, about the 12 days of Christmas. And this is easily and often misunderstood. People think the 12 days of Christmas are the 12 days before Christmas. But East and West, the 12 days before Christmas, indeed the 40 days before Christmas, we are fasting. We are not feasting. It is a time of expectant joy, but it is a sober expectation before Christmas. The 12 days of Christmas come afterwards, these days where there is no fasting from Christmas until the very eve of Theophania. So our homes are still full of the plenty of the feast, of the leftovers of the ham or the turkey or the lamb, whatever meat we've decided to cook, with all the gigang, all the pastries, all the bread, all the food is still there. We are feasting. We are celebrating. And yet, as one day turns into a next, although we are filled with the joy of the Lord's coming in the flesh to save us, we understand that we still live in a broken and fallen world. It is the fifth day of Christmas, and we are gathered to celebrate the liturgy, and yet we also observe the memorial service for those that we love who have fallen asleep, cut off, we know, too soon. The news that we see on the television is still full of trouble, still full of death and suffering and famine and loss. And even here in the church, the gospel reading that we read, although it speaks of the joy of Christ born in Bethlehem as our Savior, it speaks as well of death. And not just any death, but the death of infants who were killed as Herod searched for Jesus, trying to kill him, and instead killed all the baby boys, 2 years of age and younger, in the entire region. How do we possibly comprehend this? How do we face this? How do we balance the call of the church to celebrate, to feast, to rejoice, against the reality of a world still dominated by death? How do we live in both places at once? This is a problem. If we take it seriously, this should be deeply troubling to us. How can we possibly feast when there are those who are starving? How can we celebrate when around the world so many are still subject to sudden death? Because we are commanded to do so. It is necessary that we do so. And yet it seems heartless to us. And for most of us, we cannot do one without shutting out from our minds, without pretending that the other doesn't exist. But this is not what we are called to do. We are called, rather, and this is hard, but this is the way of the Lord. We are called to stand in the darkness of this broken and fallen world, conscious of the death and suffering that is all around us, that is within us. And in this place, we are called to look to the Lord and to rejoice because He brings salvation to us in this place of darkness. He brings life to us in this world of death. He brings hope to us in the face of hopelessness. And then our feast day, our rejoicing, our celebration becomes not an attempt to escape, to pretend, to lie to ourselves for a moment that everything is not wrong, but instead to rejoice that it is being made right. It's an entirely different thing. It's one thing to eat a lot of food because we are sad and we want to, by the means of food or whatever else we consume, to make ourselves feel better. This is the way of the world. We fall into this so easily. It is another thing in the midst of famine, in the face of hunger, in the depths of suffering, to look to Christ and see Him working salvation for us and for all the world so slowly and yet so clearly. And in the joy of that recognition, in awe of Him, to receive the good things of this world and celebrate that death is dying, that suffering is being abolished. And even if we do not yet see the end of that, our feasting then is an act not of flight, not of fancy, but of faith. That it is being made right, and therefore it is right for us to celebrate. If we can approach it in this way, then our feasting will not be a matter of gluttony, but will be a holy and a sacred thing. And if in our plenty we share with those who have need, then we bring to them too this hope, this truth, that the world is not only as we see it. But that the Lord is active here. And that we who have the hope of this salvation then become apostles, preachers, proclaimers of this joy to all the world. As we move through this festal season, as we prepare for the new year, as we gird up our loins for the labors and the challenges that face us in 2020, may we understand above all this call of the Lord to us, to be vessels of light, to be beacons of hope, to be proclaimers of joy in darkness and death and in shadow. For God is with us, and all will be well. Please stand, we will continue. king of the living.